All right. Hey, if you have a Bible this morning, I want to invite you to turn to Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians chapter 5, that's where we're going to be today. We are continuing our series in the book of Ephesians. I don't know about you guys, but has this been good for your heart like it's been for mine? Amen, amen. Well, hey, let me pray, and then we're going to jump right in, okay? Father, this morning, I just pray a simple prayer right now, that you would bless your word, that I would become unseen and that people would just see how beautiful the gospel is and how beautiful you are, Jesus, and what you've done for us and the life that you've called us to live. God, you've given us everything to live this new life, to be who we are, given us your word, each other, and your spirit. So Spirit, I ask that you would do what I can't do here this morning, and that is to change hearts and to challenge and comfort. I can't do that, so Holy Spirit, I just ask you, in Christ, let me pray, amen. Amen. Well, hey, I want to tell you about a hike that Melissa and I did this past June in Hawaii. Does anybody like to hike? Or you don't get to do it often, but you like to? Yeah, there's a lot of us that like to hike. So through a set of really kind of unique circumstances, my wife and I were invited to hike to the most wettest measured spot on Earth. Kind of cool, right? So we were invited on the island of Kauai to go to this place called the Blue Hole because a lot of water just collects at the bottom, right? And so at this Blue Hole, it gets 450 inches of rain a year, okay? So to put that in perspective, here in Chicagoland, by the way, we're not even close to being one of the most measured wettest spots in the earth. We get about 38 average a year, all right? So way more. So our friends that invite us on this hike, they warned us and said, hey, they call me JB. JB and Melissa, like, you're totally invited to go on this hike, but it's a little dangerous, all right? It could rain at any point, obviously, because it gets a lot of rain, and it could start flash flooding, and, you know, waist-high deep water could all of a sudden be 10 feet in a matter of 2 minutes, all right? And by the way, we don't know exactly the trail. Like, we could get lost in the jungle in the middle of Kauai, and it's really hard to. It takes about 10 hours. What do you guys think? So Melissa and I looked at each other. We're like, what do you think? We're in, I guess. I don't know. Like, sure, let's do it, you know? And so we were on this hike, and our ultimate destination was called the Weeping Wall. I actually have a picture of it. It's hard to scale, but we're at the bottom. It's 5,000 feet tall. So to put that in perspective, that's three Willis or Sears towers stacked on each other. That's how high this thing is, okay? It's hard to measure it on a picture. It's called the Weeping Wall because of the amount of rainwater that just cascades down. It just continually has water just going down. It's honestly beautiful. And so you got to get there, right? And so it's a three-mile hike in and then a three-mile hike right out. And the whole time you're crossing these rivers, and you're in this, it looks like, anybody seen Jurassic Park, where the helicopter goes through? Yeah, it felt like we were in Jurassic Park, because I guess we were, because they filmed it there, so yeah, it makes sense. But you're hiking through these cliffs that are just 5,000 feet, I have a picture of it. Yeah, they're like 5,000 feet, this is a 1,000-foot waterfall that we came upon. It's honestly gorgeous and beautiful. It speaks to just God's creation, right? It's incredible. So we're hiking, you're having to cross these rivers, and it feels like ice skating, because the amount of water that comes over these rocks, it smooths them over, and so you can't get any traction. And then we were climbing these cliffs, we're climbing these ridges, and you're using other people's ropes. So it's a lot of faith, okay? So you're using other people's ropes to climb these ridges, and then the ridges you'd walk on are about this wide, and then on either side, it's hundreds of feet down, all right? So this hike that we're on, we had to exercise wisdom and discernment. Everywhere literally for 6 miles, we had to discern where to place our feet. And we made it, and it was incredible, once-in-a-lifetime kind of hike. And the reason why I tell you that story is not to tell you about this amazing hike, but I tell you this story because that's exactly what Paul is exhorting the Ephesians in our text today. That's exactly what he's telling them to do. He's telling them to walk in wisdom as new believers. Pastor Jeff has done just such a great job unfolding God's word, unpacking it. And last week, and the week before, he told us to live the changed life, to be who we are. Jesus Christ has purchased a new life for us, and we walk in that new life. And so today, we're talking about what it means to walk in wisdom. We're going to walk in wisdom, all right? Is everybody ready to jump in? We got a lot to do, all right? You ready? All right, here we go. All right, the first way, if you're taking notes, that we can walk in wisdom is to act wisely. Act wisely. That's the first point. Verse 15 in Ephesians 5, the Apostle Paul writes this. Look carefully. That word carefully means to pay attention or be diligent. Then to how you walk. Not as unwise, but as wise. Making the best use of time because the days are evil. The entire conversation in Ephesians 5, Paul is saying things like this. Don't do this anymore. Don't be like this anymore because that's not who you are. The old self, the old you, if you're on Christ, has been crucified. It's gone. And the new has come. So turn from sin and turn to Christ. The old you was enslaved to sin. And you no longer serve that master anymore. You could say no. No to that master. And you can say yes to Jesus and what he wants for you in this life. And the word walk, I don't know if you guys have caught up on this and are studying Ephesians, but the word walk comes up a lot. It's used 8 times in the book of Ephesians. And it's used 3 times in Ephesians 5. Paul says in verse 1 of chapter 5, be imitators of Jesus and walk in love as Christ. And then he says later on, walk in the light. Out of darkness, walk in light. And then here he's saying, walk and act wisely. Now, this word wise or wisdom, it's not talking about like being super smart. It doesn't mean mere intelligence. What it means is to apply what you've been taught. It means to do what you know is right. That's what wisdom is. It's not being like super intellectual, being super smart. It means, hey, what you've been taught, what you know to be true, do that. That's what wisdom is. How many of you guys have been watching the Olympics? Anybody been watching the Olympics? Yeah, here's what I found out at the Olympics, by the way. You can't look at the news in the morning because it shows you the results, but it doesn't show you like, you know, prime time at 7 p.m. It doesn't show you like the actual thing, but you already know the results. Anyway, just me? Okay, whatever. The Olympics. How many of you guys have heard of Simone Biles, the amazing gymnastics? Yeah, isn't she incredible? She's like, I think she's called the GOAT, not like a sheep goat like that, but like the greatest of all time. Okay, Michael Jordan's that, by the way, too, right? Chicago fans. All right, yeah. Not LeBron, thank you. All right, anyway, back to the sermon, all right? Back to the sermon. Simone Biles, if you've been following the Olympics, she has withdrawn from all her events, and she's withdrawn due to mental health, and arguably she's the greatest gymnastics ever to live, right? And so I found a quote from her of the why and the reason why she's stepped back, and she said, quote, I took a step back from my events because I didn't want to do something silly out there and get injured when I'm not prepared, okay? Why did she do that? Why did she back out from the events? On the biggest stage in the world, the greatest gymnastic athlete arguably to live, why would she withdraw? Well, she withdrew because wisdom told her, if I'm not mentally ready, if I'm not prepared to do these insane flips, then it'd be foolish to do it. That's wisdom. It's applying what you know. It's applying what you know. In contrast to wise living, what is unwise and foolish living? Well, unwise and foolish living is this, and this is what Paul is saying. Don't do that. Don't be unwise. It's knowing what to do but not do it. That's what it means to be foolish. That's what the author of Proverbs means when he talks about wisdom and foolishness. It's not applying what you know to be right and true. Another example. How many guys have got your wisdom teeth out before, or you have a son or daughter, know someone that got their wisdom teeth out? Okay, yeah. So my wife, my sweet Melissa, she's at camp right now, bless her heart. She just got 4 wisdom teeth out, all were impacted 3 weeks ago. And so if you know the drill, she just got them out like down the road. If you know the drill, you drop off your loved one or friend or family at the wisdom teeth place, and then they tell you don't leave the parking lot because it only takes like 45 minutes. So me and her mom are waiting in the parking lot. And we get the call, so you go back, and they're totally drugged up. And so they tell you the instructions, right? They say, hey, like here's a sheet. Here's how you take care of your loved one. And because obviously they're drugged up. By the way, I have a lot of videos of Melissa drugged up. Should I play some? No, just kidding. Wisdom, don't be foolish. I choose life. Okay, so So Melissa, you get these instructions, right? And it basically says, hey, here's what not to do and here's what to do. And part of the instructions say, hey, it's not wise to eat these things. So like Melissa, she couldn't eat pizza. She loves pizza. She couldn't have chips. She couldn't drink out of a straw. It would have been incredibly foolish for her or her mom and I to say, hey, just eat chips on day one. No problem at all. Or drink out of a straw. You won't get dry sockets. They don't know what they're talking about. That would have been foolish, right? That'd have been completely foolish. So here's what Paul, back to the text, here's what Paul is saying. Here's what he's communicating to the Ephesians, and here's what it means for us today. He's calling them to examine the scope of their life, to see if their life is characterized by wise choices, to see if their life is characterized by godly wisdom. That's the point here, to look at your life and say, am I making godly, wise choices? To take what they know and for us to take what we know to be true of what's in God's word and what he's spoken to us in community, in the context of community, and applying it. And here's the thing, church, if we start to do this, if we start to characterize our life and examine our life and ask God to fill us up with more faith and to make wise, godly, wise choices, two things are going to happen. One, you're going to be living the life that God wants you to live. You're going to be living the changed life. You're going to be living the life in being who you are. And secondly, you're going to begin to have standards. You're going to have standards in your life to measure all your decisions that come at you. Guys, we make decisions all the time, every day. There's not a day where we don't use wisdom and discernment. We need it every day. But you'll have a standard to measure all those things. And also, when temptation comes in your life, you're going to be able to make the wise choice, not the foolish choice. So just a few examples. Like if you're at a point in your life where you're dating someone or maybe dating someone or going to marry someone, is it wise as you, as a believer, to marry someone or date someone opposed to Jesus Christ and the gospel? Is that wise? Is it wise to be close to a coworker of the opposite sex if you're married? Is it wise if you struggle with pornography or lust to have unfiltered access on your phone and not be in accountability or have a smartphone at all? Is that wise? And these are just a few examples, not exhaustive, but you see where it's going. So my question here for you is this. Is your life characterized by godly wisdom? Is your life characterized by wise living or foolishness? What is it? Does your life match a life on the path to godly wisdom? Paul goes on. He says this. Be wise, making the best use of time because the days are evil. So the way that we can understand this, making the best use of time, is one, to understand that we are God's ambassadors. We are God's ambassadors. We are his representatives here on earth. We are his church. We are his plan to redeem the world. Okay, that's what that word, that's what making the best use, it means redeem, it means to buy back. Anybody watch those Fixer Upper shows on Netflix or TV? That's the idea here, is to buy back and fix up and redeem it. So as Christians, we are to look at time that God's given us and steward it well and make the best use of it. So you have to understand that you as a Christian, ready for this? You're a full-time missionary. You're a full-time missionary. You are God's ambassadors. You are God's only plan to make a difference for the kingdom. The church, not the building, but his people. We are God's plan to push the kingdom forward. So you have to view yourself as a Christian first, as God's ambassador first, not a husband, not a son, not a child, but you are not even your ethnicity. You are a Christian first if you're in Christ. You got to understand, you are God's ambassadors. And also understand this, wherever God has placed you sovereignly, at your job, at work, school, church, in your neighborhoods, the influence you have in relationships, you have to view that also as an opportunity to make the best use of your time. You have to. Like where I am, where Melissa and I are in our neighborhood, everybody around us does not know Jesus. We said, thank you, Lord, seriously, because we want to make a difference in our neighborhood. And we're trying. And hopefully, you begin to do that, or you are doing that. You got to view yourself as an ambassador for Christ, as a full-time missionary. How can I, Lord, leverage and steward my time for your name and your glory? That's how you make the best use of your time. Because he says why. Look back. He says, because the days we live in are, what's it say? Are evil. Not good, but evil. It doesn't take very long for us, for you, to watch a minute of the news, scroll a little bit on Facebook or social media, and see that this world is sinful, right? It doesn't take very long. This world we live in is messed up. It's evil. It's sinful. It's not getting any better. And praise Jesus, it's not always going to be like that, right? Like, we have a hope where Jesus is going to come back and restore everything, the new earth, the new heavens. It's not going to be like this forever. But for now, it's evil. On top of that, we also have an enemy. We have an enemy that's against us. Scripture tells us that he seeks to kill and destroy. He wants to mess up everything. And I think sometimes we tend as Christians just to think that, like, it's the big things that the enemy wants us to engage in. That is true, but it's so much more than anything. You know what? The enemy can use just busyness to distract us and get us off the course. The enemy, I read this book. Have you guys ever heard of Screwtape Letters by C.S. Lewis? It's basically this book about how a higher demon is training another demon. It's not scriptural, but it's kind of the idea. It's training them to get Christians off their walk. And I'll never forget in a line in that book, he says, he's training the other demon. He says, hey, if a deck of cards will do the trick, great. Basically saying, hey, anything can distract a Christian. Guys, our enemy is a deceiver, liar. Wants you to get off track with the Lord, and he'll use everything to deceive you and get you off track. And we know this as a church. He'll try to disrupt even what's going inside, what is good and holy and true in our church. We know that to be true too. He's everywhere. So we have to be intentional. We have to be intentional of our time. So let me ask you this. Are you making the best use of your time? Are you making the best use of your time? Are you stewarding and leveraging all that God has given you to make sure everybody knows the gospel truth? Because listen, we have the answer. Amen? Amen? And listen, I just want to, this is going to sound a little urgent and straightforward. This is not a time for Christians to pull back in the times we're living in. It's not time for us to be in our little bubbles. It's not time for us to stay inside the church. The world needs the gospel message more than ever. It's not a time for us to pull back. We've been saved to make a difference. I want to say it like this. We've been made for these times. You've been made for these times. We have the answer to racism, to abortion, to gender confusion, to the devaluing of marriage and the family, to hatred. We have all those answers. You know what the answer is? It's Jesus. It's the gospel. And the light shines most when it's dark. And we live in dark and evil times. So here's what I'm saying to all of us, including myself this morning. Wake up and look for the opportunities that God has before you. And see what joy comes out of you when you see those opportunities and God uses you. And listen, he's always going to use you more than your capabilities. You know why? Because I'm standing here today as a pastor. I never thought this was possible. Never thought this was possible. If God can do it in me, he can do it in you. All right? Look at all the people in the Bible. None of them had their life together. God uses tons of people, murderers, prostitutes, tax collectors. He can sure use ordinary people like us. Amen? Second point in how we can walk wisely, we have to think wisely, okay? We have to have our mind renewed. Paul says in verse 17, therefore, so in light of what I've just said, what Paul's just said, do not be foolish. That word foolish, what's it mean? It means you know what's right, but you don't do what's right. Understand the will of God. But understand the will of God. Now, that's a big topic in the church, the will of God. That's a huge topic. That's a big topic. People ask that question all the time. I get that question a lot as a pastor. Hey, what's God's will for my life? Well, it's usually when someone has a big decision in their life, right? It's like, should I date this person? Should I marry this person? That's God's will for me. Or should I take this job? Should I move to California or Florida or, you know, somewhere else, or does God want me here? I don't want to move to Dallas, Texas, if God's will is for me to be in Chicagoland, right? Should I take this job? Should I buy this house? Should I invest in here? What's God's will for my life? I get that question all the time, right? So I don't have time to like deep dive into it, but I'm gonna suggest two books. If you ever asked the question, what's God's will for my life? These are your two books you wanna read, all right? And it can be extremely helpful not only to you, but to other people. The first book is called Just Do Something, okay? Just Do Something, it's by Kevin DeYoung. It's a little older book, you know, early 2000s, which that's not too old. It's a great book, it helped me tremendously. The second book is Decision Making and the Will of God by Gary Friesen, okay? If you didn't have time to write that down, just come up after me, I'll give you my notes. Basically, these two pastors and authors address how to find out God's will in your life, okay? So there's three wills of God. All right, we have these on the screen. The first is God's will of decree. Okay, God's will of decree. This is God's sovereignty. This is everything that God has planned, everything that God has ordained to happen, and all the plans, everything that God has ordained, it's going to happen. It's going to happen. There's no if, and, or buts, okay? No one can thwart God's sovereign plans, okay? That's God's will of decree. The second is God's will of direction, okay? God's will of direction. And this is what people usually are hung up on, like, what does God want me to do? Should I move? Should I date this person? Okay. Spoiler alert, the book says that there's not some, and this is true of God's word, there's not some secret hidden plan that you have to discover in God's word. Or like God's like, if John just prays the right prayer, if he just sees the sign I'm about to give him, then I'll tell him my secret, then I'll tell him the will. No, that's not how God operates, okay? The book in the Bible actually gives a very helpful helpful steps on how you can make a decision, okay? So I just want to go over this real quick. It's not always like this, okay, but it's helpful, okay? So when you come to a decision, like some of the ones I named, example, like should I marry, date this person? Should I take this job? Okay, the process is this, is go to God's word, okay? Go to God's word. And that doesn't mean like to search the scriptures. If you're like trying to decide if you're dating someone, you're all of a sudden you're in the book of Joshua, you're like, I'm in the book of Joshua. The guy I'm dating, his name's Josh. I should marry him. No, like, that's not what that means, okay? It means search the scriptures and see if the decision you're about to make is sinful or not sinful. That's what it means, okay? You're not going to find a verse that says, move to Dallas, okay? That's not going to be in the Bible, okay? It doesn't exist, okay? So be in God's word. Pray about your decision. And then also, God has given us a wonderful gift in one another. So take your decision and bring it to your small group. Bring it to another Christian, because God speaks through his people, his bride, okay? So ask your friends, hey, should I move here or should I date this guy? No, don't date him. Don't date him. And then you ask another friend, should I date this guy? No. What should you probably do? Not date that person, because wise counsel is speaking in and giving feedback into that decision, okay? And then fourth, make a decision. Make a decision. Don't tinker. Be patient, but don't tinker too much. Make a decision, and then finally trust God when you make that decision, okay? Maybe that was incredibly freeing to you this morning. And the will, the third will that Paul is talking about, that he's referring to in our text today, is God's will of desire, or God's moral will. This is what Paul is talking about, okay? This refers to how God commands us to live. And Paul is saying, understand, find out, comprehend how God wants you to live, and do it. That's wise living, okay? So how do we understand God's will? How do we understand God's will of desire for us? Well, you have it right here. It's written down. It's his Bible. It's our Bible. It's his word. That's how you know God's will for you. 1 Thessalonians 4:3 says it perfectly. For this is God's will, your sanctification. That's God's will for your life. What does sanctification mean? That's a big churchy word. It means to grow in holiness. That's what it means. It means to grow in holiness. To put on Christ, to live a holy life, that's what God wants of you. So what is God's will? What does Paul say to the Ephesians? He says, live the changed life. Be more holy. Pursue Jesus. Repent. Put on Christ. In all your decisions, you can't go wrong with putting on Jesus Christ. In Psalm 119, verse 11, it says this, I've hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. In Romans 12, 2 puts it perfectly. It says, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what the will of God is, what is good and acceptable and perfect. Church, you can know God's will for your life. In the day-to-day, it's not hard to understand what his will is for you because it's written in his word. So my question at this point is this. Are you allowing God's word to shape your thinking? Are you allowing God's word to shape your thinking? Or are you leaning on your own wisdom or worldly wisdom or what just feels right, what just feels good? Maybe you're in here and you're coming to some decisions in your life. You're at one maybe today. I hope and my prayer is that you're leaning on God's word and wise counsel. And please don't look to a social media influencer. Don't look to social media. Be known. Be known by people who love Jesus and that you're doing life in 3D. Does that make sense? Make a decision based on the Lord and his people's counsel. All right? Is your thinking being shaped by God's word? Verse 18. The third point, our final point this morning is this. To act wisely, we have to walk wisely, we must act wisely, and we must think wisely. And finally, we must yield wisely. Yield wisely. Let's look at verse 18. It says this, and do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit. All right, we're just hitting all the big topics today. Wisdom, foolishness, the will of God, and alcohol. Let's go, all right? We're packing it all in this morning, all right? All right, so first off, this verse is typically used by people who want to drink. They say, oh, see, I can drink, Pastor John. I can have alcohol because it says as long as I don't get drunk. Okay, not Paul's intention. That's not his main reason here, okay? Paul is using a worldly example, okay, of what foolishness looks like and contrasting it to what it means to be filled with the Spirit, okay? But since we're here, let's talk about alcohol. All right, we're going to talk about it. First off, I want to say this, is that I know that there's a lot of us in here and the spectrum's wide, and maybe you come from a family that alcohol has done tremendous hurt and you're healing or in the process of healing. I get that. A little of my family has that too. Some of you guys are on the other side of the spectrum and you're like, listen, I enjoy it. Okay, some of you guys have had a rough past with it and maybe you're in the midst of that still. Or you come out of it. Wide spectrum. What I want to do here in this is first, I want to be clear what God's word says. Not me, but what God's word says. But I want to be urgent, and I want to be loving. Does that make sense? That's my intention. No, nothing else, okay? So first off, you're about alcohol. You're not going to find an official stance from our church about it because we believe this is what we call a Christian liberty. We believe that believers with alcohol can exercise freedom in this. There's not a command, okay? You're not going to find a command in God's word, about to go over some, that says that drinking alcohol is outright a sin. Wine is that, it's a sin. We're going to get to it, okay? But the Bible is clear about consumption and who can and who shouldn't, okay? So let's go over these, all right? We have these on the screen. First, debauchery and drunkenness is always a sin. It's always a sin. There's no, is that okay? It's always a sin. Okay, that's from our text today, Ephesians 5, 18. It says it clearly, do not get drunk, okay? You know what it means in the Greek? Do not get drunk, okay? Debauchery is a sin, all right? That's what it means, all right? That's what it means in the Greek, all right? Look it up. Second, if you're under the age of 21, you should not consume alcohol. It's always a sin. Well, there's not a verse that says that, Pastor John, if you're under the age of 21. Well, Romans 13, verses 1 through 3 says this, that all believers are to submit to authorities, okay? And that includes the government. I know it's not a super popular verse, but that's what God's word says, so we submit. If you're under the age of 21, no alcohol consumption. Third, if you, that's important, you think that drinking alcohol is wrong, that you're going to deny to your conscience by drinking alcohol, it is a sin for you, and you shouldn't, okay? That's Romans 14, verse 23. And then finally, if it causes another brother or sister, if it hurts your witness, then you shouldn't. Okay, that's Romans 14, 13. If alcohol controls you, if you're dependent on it, it's sinful. Okay? So under those guidelines, under those things, you have the freedom and you can exercise your Christian liberty to drink. Okay? But I want to say this. The sermon today is on wisdom. And I encourage and exhort you as your pastor to drink wisely under the Bible's teaching as it is to believers. And be careful and drink it and drink carefully. Okay? Does that make sense? And also, this is not in my notes, but we are never to push that on anybody else. We are never to push it. If it makes someone uncomfortable, or they have a struggle, you always err on the side of love, right? Love God, and then who do we love secondly? People, not yourself. You're way down the list. You love others, okay? Put yourself, because that's what Christ would do, all right? So back to our verse. What is Paul saying here? He's saying this. He's taking a worldly escape, a worldly example, that's foolish, drunkenness, and comparing it to being filled with the Spirit, okay? So when you get drunk, when you are under the influence, you have no control. Alcohol takes over you, right? It takes over you. You say things that you probably may never would have said. You do things that you probably would not normally do. Your judgment, your coordination, your balance is terrible. You don't even know until you're not drunk, right? And God desires us all to live a sober life. That's what happens. But what does Paul say? He doesn't just say, don't do this, but he says, but be filled with the Spirit. Be filled with the Spirit. Okay, so to give you an example, here's what happens when we're filled with the Spirit. When the Spirit comes upon our lives as believers, when we ask God to fill us with the Spirit, God, would you fill my life? What is good? What is true? What is right? What the Spirit does when we're in God's Word, when we're in godly community, all of a sudden, the Spirit is putting what I call deposits, spiritual deposits into our lives. So, fruits of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and what's the last one? Self-control. Gosh, I struggle with that one. The Spirit, it does all those things. It puts it in us, and he fills us up. So this is us, and this is the Spirit putting all those spiritual deposits in us. And then what starts to happen as the Spirit fills you? You start to overflow with spiritual things. And so in your community where God has placed you as an ambassador, as a missionary, what starts to happen is that those things start overflowing in your life. And it gets out to other people. And it changes you, but it also changes other people. That's what it means to be filled with the Spirit. And that's what Paul is saying to the Ephesians. Be filled with what is good and true. Because when you fill your life with those things, you're going to act in wisdom, and it's going to come out of you, and it's going to overflow to your family, to your friends, and to your church. That's what it means to be filled with the Spirit. That's what God desires. So this morning, if you find yourself here and you struggle with drunkenness, what I want to tell you is this. You came to the right place this morning. You came to the right place this morning. Jesus is a ready, available Savior. He's a ready, available Savior, and he can handle anything you bring to him. All right? Finally, the worship band, you guys can come up. I want to close with some quick verses. Look at verse 19. It says, but be filled with the Spirit, addressing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody to the Lord with your heart. All right, does this mean that, does Paul say that we have to find ourselves in like a musical and that we need to be like skipping and jumping and singing songs to each other? Yes, that's what it means. No, I'm just kidding, all right? And that's not what he means, all right? I know some of you would love to just be caught up in a musical. I know you, okay? Not what he means here, okay? Spiritual songs and psalms and hymns, these are worship songs. That's how we can understand it, okay? Notice, here's what I want you to notice. He says, addressing one another. So this has a horizontal relationship, but also a vertical relationship. Okay, we sing songs to God. Okay, we get that. We do that every time we gather here on Sunday morning, right? We worship God. We sing psalms and hymns to God, right? Why do we sing on Sunday morning, and why do we sing when we gather mostly all the time? It's because we're lifting up the name of Jesus. We're bringing God glory. We're magnifying his name for all that he's done for us and how good he is and that he saved us. And it increases our faith. And also, it's really encouraging. And also, the second thing is that it's horizontal. I bet you guys, maybe you didn't know this, but when we sing worship songs, we're not just singing to God, but we're actually singing to one another. Do you guys know that? Isn't that cool? We're actually singing to one another. And it's incredibly encouraging and unifying. You know why? Because of a few things. Number one, I don't know if you guys noticed this, but Melissa and I, we always sit down here. The reason why I like sitting up front is not because like I have to do announcements or come on stage. That's a little bit of it. Because it's such a great view to see everybody worship. Like I could just kind of look out this way and just see the view of worship. Because listen, when I see that 10 or 16-year-old student sing, don't tell me something doesn't happen in your heart that's encouraging and increases your faith, right? It's incredibly encouraging. It's incredibly unifying. It's amazing. Or check this out. Or when you know someone that's going through a struggle in a deep valley, and they're not out of it, but they're here, they show up to church, and they're lifting their hands to Jesus, and they're singing songs like what we just sang, Waymaker. Like, even when I don't see you're working, I'm in, Jesus. I'm in, God. Yes, I will. I choose to praise. Or great is your faithfulness, God. Does that do something in your heart and soul? Of course it does. And that's what it means to sing horizontal. Or maybe that person that's going through a valley can't sing just because it's too hard. Maybe that song, it's not because they don't believe the song, but they just can't utter those words this morning. But you're singing, and they see you, and your faith, your fervor for Jesus, your testimony, even though you don't see it, it's encouraging them. That's what it means to address one another in songs. And this is what Paul says is a result of when we're filled with the Spirit. We sing songs to God, yes, but also we're singing to each other, which increases our faith and our love. Verse 20 says, giving thanks for everything to God, the Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We are to live a life of gratitude for the Lord, for everything he's done for us. And finally, it says, submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ. It means that we voluntarily yield to each other because Jesus did that. I know submission is not like a super popular word in our culture, maybe even our church sometimes, but that's what we do. And the greatest example of this is Jesus Christ. More on that later. I'll let Pastor Jeff handle submission next week, all right? Jeff can do that next week, all right? But as I close, here's the question I want to ask you this morning as we wrap up. Are you walking in wisdom as a changed believer in Christ Jesus? Can you characterize your life as a wise life? Are you being who you are? Jesus, we love you so much. Just thank you for your word. It points us to who you are and what you've done for us. And God, my prayer is that we continue just to live wise lives, God. That we be characterized by godly wisdom in how we think and how we act and how we conduct our lives. So God, unify us together here. May we continue to build our lives, our community and our church around the truth that you've given us in your word. This is your will for us, Jesus. We love you. And everybody said, amen.